This book was one of the scariest and darkest ones I've ever read. And I felt like if not for the book review, I might not have even completed the book. I don't think I might have had the heart to complete the book. So I'll start. So 1984 is one of George Orwell's masterpieces. He wrote it right after the end of the Second World War in 1948, 2 years after he died. And that was a period where he had seen, you know, intense suffering and, you know, sort of, I think, heartless behavior from, you know, people at the top of governments who decided, you know, just war methods and the desolation and suffering he was seeing around him. And this book shows his strong opposition to totalitarian governments, which are systems where the government controls everything of the people. People have no freedom. They are under 24/7 video monitoring. They don't have freedom of speech, freedom of actions, freedom of thought. That is, if it seems like they have thoughts against the government, they will be taken, tortured, and killed. In this world, there is also a practice of historical negationism, which means today, if there is some change in the government, they will act like जो पहले था वो कभी था भी नहीं. तुम लोग सिर्फ अपने दिमाग में झूठ सोच रहे हो. वो था भी नहीं, वो हुआ भी नहीं कभी. हम हमारे records भी यही दिखाते हैं. So the point is the government actively erases historical records and replaces it with their version of what's happening to them. With this, they are denying people. They are acting as if people have no memories of their own. And they should not even have memories of their own, because what the government thinks is the only thing you can think. The main character of the book, his name is Winston Smith. He lives in London. He's a government employee whose work is primarily erasing evidence of the past, which looks bad on the government. So, har roz wo baithta apne office mein, usko aise he gets information ki पिछले एक साल पहले के न्यूज़पेपर में एडिशन करना एडिट करना चाहिए. आज अब ये हुआ नहीं क्योंकि आज हमें पता कि वो झूठ था, तो चेंज कर देना चाहिए. मतलब वो हुआ भी नहीं कभी. इन दिस बुक द गवर्नमेंट केयर्स केयरफुली, आई मीन मॉनिटर्स केयरफुली मोस्ट पीपल, बट दे लेट गो द पुअर सेक्शन ऑफ सोसाइटी. द गवर्नमेंट ट्रीट्स देम लाइक एनिमल्स. And because of that, they don't care. Unka video surveillance nahi hota hai. Kyunki in their mind, they are not even worthy of that. It's okay, they live like animals, we don't care. Unko, you know, we'll not give them basic necessities, that's their responsibilities, but they have at least the freedom of thought and action. So, hamare jo main character hai, Mr. Smith, he's a rebel. He has thoughts against the government, and they're very small things at first. Like, he wants to buy a diary and he goes to the black market and buys a diary where he wants to write things on his own. And that itself is, you know, revolution against the government, because itna tightly jo control karta hai government. I'm not going to give too much away of the plot, because I think it's a scary book, sure, but it's one we all must read in the present times. I feel like somebody is mentioning yesterday, I think the saddest part about 1984 is that it's always been relevant.
Okay.
This is not mine. I don't know who said this yesterday, but one, maybe not the case. So I'd like to just talk to you about one of the party's beliefs. And the belief is war is peace. Okay. So in this novel, Jo Duniya, it's divided into three super continents. Oceania, in which Britain and America and Australia are part of. East Asia and Eurasia. Eurasia is Russia and the European countries, and East Asia is like China, Japan, and all of that. Throughout the world, they're doing it. Oceania, which Mr. Smith belongs to, is constantly at war with one of the continents. Constantly. This is a recurring thing. War hota rehta hai. Like, isko fark nahi padta at this point, because it's always going on. And every few years, to wo ek continent ke saath juda hai ki they're fighting the war and what they're fighting against. Every few years, their ally and the enemy keep changing, or the Eurasia and East Asia. And every time that happens, throughout the book, Oceania starts fighting East Asia instead. Then the government makes it seem ki wo hamesha se East Asia se hi ladte hain. They never even fought with Eurasia. That's all stupid. And if you think that, it's just, you know, your own hallucination. Wo kabhi hua hi nahi. The explanation for constant war is revealed that the so that the poorer classes of society receive just the minimum resources for their survival, and all the surplus resources are used for a constant meaningless war. This they find as their reason. See, they want the poor people to not have enough control over their lives, to act as if they never have too much so they can return. So इनका idea ये है कि अगर we ask them to make resources and then destroy them, they think that it's useless. They'll understand that you're using them for nothing. But their point is, अगर they work in industries, they do work, they make goods, and all of the extras are sent off to war, they solve two problems. One is that they ensure that there are never too many resources so the poor are under control. And two, they actually feel patriotic because they're helping their country fight a war. They in their head don't think that the war is meaningless, and they just accept it. The constant war, the author points out, is equivalent to peace inside the community. Because as long as they are in harmony, they believe they're working towards a cause, everything's fine. The government's happy, people are happy. This is their second dogma: war is peace. I will not talk about my, you know, my learnings and all of that. So I have this line. I want to draw comparisons to the world today, because when I read the book, I wasn't really scared. I kept thinking that this is not only fiction. It's not fiction. This, there are two recurring themes in the back of my mind. One, that, oh my god, this is like the darkest place that we could be in our society. Number two, we're already halfway there. We live currently in a world where the government of a nation country can deny that millions of its citizens are being ruthlessly killed and suffered just on the basis of the faith and the God they choose to worship. A world where blatant lies are termed alternative facts. And if this is not negationism, the same way it is in the book, I don't know what it is. A world where police officers in Egypt can impersonate gay men on gay dating sites and use it to capture them, torture them, put them in jail. A world, even in the 1980s, where, you know, India performs four sterilizations without even telling people, their bodies, no, we don't care, you belong to us. So the same thing of, you know, police officers impersonating in Egypt, impersonating gay men and catching them on dating sites is very similar to one of the characters in the book, who as Mr. Smith initially trusts, then he can't, his entire worldview is shattered. When you develop trust with somebody like that, you expect, I mean, the trust to remain the same way it is, right? But in the book and in real life, that doesn't seem to be happening. We live in a world where America's National Security Association agency openly admits to spying on its citizens and even on the, you know, the leader of Germany. If this is not surveillance, what is? Big Brother is watching. I want to end with this. One of Winston's problems with everybody else in the society is that unko ye sabhi kaise lag raha hai? Why can they not see that this is not normal? Why can they not see that any society is better than this? We must ask ourselves the question, are we going to be the same sort of people who sit by and watch? In action, just sit by and do nothing. It's sort of like an experiment, right? When you put a frog into a boiling pot of water, it jumps immediately out. If you put it in water and slowly boil it, it will just sit there. Because everything is so slow that it does not feel the temperature change, it thinks it's normal. Are we, the stupid frog does not realize that because change is gradual over it, so we are there, it's okay. Should we choose to do this? Thank you.
So उसके में भी छोटी सी कविता लिखी है, which is about that world, if you want to mention it.
इट्स कॉल्ड दो और वो पांच है।
बस आपको बताना चाहती हूँ आज कि दो और दो ना पांच है, मैं मान लो मैं गलत हूँ, दो और दो ना पांच है। तुम्हें शायद लगता है वो धीरा है पर असल में वो पांच है, दो और दो ना पांच है। वो कैसे? अगर दो सेब हैं और तीन सेब हैं तो एक सेब ना बुरा है, पर वो बुरा तो एक शब्द ही नहीं, अच्छा ना होने का सारांश है। तो दो और दो पांच है। चलो बुरे सेबों में कहानियों में पूछना तो पड़ता है कि इतिहास में क्या कुछ कभी बुरा था, पर मानो ओझल हो गई हर ऐसी जांच है, तो दो और दो पांच है। चलो पिछला इतिहास नहीं हमारा आज इतिहास बन सके, लेकिन कदम उठाना अपनी जिंदगी पर पांच है, और दो पांच है। चलो कदम उठा लिया तुमने, पर पत्र लिखना मना है और ना ही इश्क करने का रोमांच है, तो दो और दो पांच है। इश्क भी अगर चुप चुप के कर लिया तुमने तो तुम्हें ना हमेशा वो देख रहा है और इसका मन दूसरों का बस नाच है, तो दो और दो पांच है। लेकिन बात यह है कि तुम्हारे और मेरे लिए वो से बुरा भी हो सकता है, कलम उठाई भी जा सकती है, इतिहास लिखा जा चुका है, ना ही बेइंतहा मोहब्बत करना रुका है। लेकिन फायदा क्या? फायदा क्या इस आजादी का जो सबको नहीं मिट्टी से हमें है, पर हम अपनी गुलामी की जिंदगी में जमे हैं। फायदा क्या अगर गिनती आने के बावजूद एक दो तीन चार गिन नहीं सकते तो? ये तो तुम्हारी साजिश का कांच है ना, तो पांच है, तो आज ही तो और तो पांच है। इसीलिए बता रही हूँ, सुन लो, दो और दो ना पांच है। तुम्हें लगता है वो गिरा है पर असल में वो पांच है, दो और दो पांच है। थैंक यू।